Welcome to our last panel. As you know, the bios are in your program of our last panel of rock star women. You know, you know, Eleanor, Anita, who brought sexual harassment to our consciousness, Sandra Fluke, who made a fool of Rush Limbaugh. And who is a newlywed. She just got married 2 weeks ago. And Secretary Hilda Solis, our first Latino cabinet member.
Well, I'm just going to sit back and let them take it from here. But no, seriously, Anita Hill here on my immediate left, she was thrust into the headlines more than 20 years ago when she testified before the Senate Judiciary Committee during the confirmation hearing for then Supreme Court Justice nominee Clarence Thomas. The televised hearings galvanized women politically, and we got the year of the woman, 1992, when a record number of women were elected to Congress. And since then, Professor Hill has been writing and lecturing. She's at Brandeis now, but she's been writing and lecturing around the country, indeed around the world, about law, public policy, and women's rights. So, Professor Hill, if you could just give us a little window into what that personal experience was like and how it transformed your life, and I think maybe redirected your mission for the intervening decades that have since passed.
Oh boy, a little window. Well, I will say that it is Columbus Day weekend, 2013, and it was Columbus Day weekend, 1991, when I testified. And so it was really interesting. I think Amy captured it in a story that she said she was at a wedding over the weekend. And in 1991. And there were arguments throughout the wedding party, and it was sort of men versus women. I think that there were a lot of arguments that took place about women's real experiences in the workplace, where women said, you know, that sounds very familiar. And men, just like the US Senate, were pretty incredulous. And I will say, and I'm going to come back to this at the end of some points that I want to make, we have come a long way since 1991. One of the things that I think is most compelling is that we now are able to talk about our experiences. In 1991, people didn't. And one of the liberating things that I believe has happened socially is that we have in so many ways dropped the shame of those experiences, and for many of us at least stopped blaming ourselves and have been able to move on and to make some positive changes for women in the workplace. And that has been 22 years of a lot of people working really, really hard, and we're not entirely there yet. But we will be moving in the right direction. But I tell people, you know, it's taken decades and scores and thousands of years, really, hundreds and thousands of years to get us where we are now. It's not going to change all in 22. And so we have this snapshot of today, sort of 50 years ago, what was the status of women. And you know, we've been charged as this last panel to talk about where women are today. Well, we've got a lot to cover. So, but in preparations for doing this, one of the things I did was to go back and listen to that tape of Eleanor Roosevelt and John Kennedy. And after some pleasantries in this exchange, Mrs. Roosevelt says to President Kennedy, why aren't there more women leaders? in this, in the United States. I mean, we're a privileged country, we're educated women. Why aren't there more leaders? And it occurred to me when I was going back through just trying to figure out how we are going to talk about where we are today. I think what we have to be willing to do is to ask, like Eleanor Roosevelt did, the difficult questions. The questions that, you know, may be a little bit embarrassing for some people to try to answer, but really are there to sort of engage and move us in a direction that perhaps the president wasn't even thinking about going when he entered the room and entered in that conversation. So today I want to talk a little bit about what those difficult questions are that are going to move us from where we are today. I want to talk a little bit about women's leadership. I want to talk about some of the things that I care very much about, which happen to be research, but also research specifically in health and medicine. And then I do want to talk a little bit about sexual harassment, and I want to just talk a smidgen about housing, because it's a topic that is not covered very much. I'm not going to cover wages and employment or education even as I could. But let's think about where we are today in terms of women's leadership. And I will sort of frame it not in terms of 50 years ago, but in terms of 20 years ago. 20 years ago when I testified before the Senate, I was, there were 98 men in the US Senate who were voting on Clarence Thomas's confirmation. Two women. One Democrat, one Republican. And today, 20 years later, as of the election, most recent election, there are 20 women in the US Senate. That's real progress. And I think how the conversation might have been different in the Senate chambers had there been 20 women in the Senate rather than the two that were there. 20 years ago on the Senate Judiciary Committee, on the Supreme Court, there were two sitting women at the time. We now have moved to three women sitting justices on the U.S. Supreme Court, and certainly that's progress. One very active retired Supreme Court justice, Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, that's progress. But when I talk about asking the next question, we can say, yes, it's great to have women on the Supreme Court and making decisions that will impact women's lives. But we can't be satisfied until we are able to say we're going to be able to sustain that. And how are we going to be able to sustain it? And to do that, we've got to sort of look at what the pipeline for women in the courts looks like. Women getting to those leadership positions. And that's what I think is sort of the next question. Not whether we've made progress, but are we going to be able to sustain and build on it? And what are the kinds of structures and the kinds of social and political structures that keep us from being able to do that? So that's sort of the next move I think we have to make. And for those of you who don't think that women are going to make a difference on the court, I just say to you, think about the Justice Ginsburg's dissent in Lilly Ledbetter versus Goodyear. Had she not read that dissent from the bench, I am absolutely certain that there would not have been so much momentum as to for Congress to actually act to correct the Supreme Court's decision. She didn't, in fact, change the decision of the court, but I think the impact that she had in that decision was much longer term. So women are there on the court. We need to be there. We need to be interpreting the laws that affect women's lives. And we need to be there to be that reality check, to talk about what women's experiences really are. Couple of other points I want to make, and then I'm going to move on. I want to talk a little bit, because I've sort of, in this last 20 years, I've been dealing with a number of issues. Mm-hmm. One of the issues has been medical research. And I've been advised of this by a wonderful member of the community, Dr. Paula Johnson, who couldn't be here today, but she is the director of the Women's Center at Brigham and Women's College, or Brigham and Women's Hospital. And 20 years ago, she reminds me, 20 years ago, Congress passed the National Institute for Health Revitalization Act. And you probably didn't know it, because I didn't know it until I was told, that when that act was passed, for the first time, when an NIH grant was given and research was funded, for the first time, the law required that women and people of color be a part of the research. Now, before then, you could just do all the studies you want and you could do it only on men. But until then, after the act, there was a requirement to include women and people of color. However, in the area of cardiovascular health, still today, only 35% of the research projects include women. And then, of those 35%, only 31% break down the information based on gender. So what's that doing? It's creating this gap, really, in between what the law's intent is and what is actually happening in research. So, you know, you have to ask that next question. Yes, we're in a great place. We have the law in place. But is it having the effect that we want it to have? I could talk about women in the foreclosure crisis and the fact that there is ample evidence, for example, that women were targeted for subprime loans and targeted for some of the most toxic loans that were given out during the period. And those loans were the ones that were most likely to be foreclosed on. Unfortunately, much of that evidence hasn't been followed through. Women have been losing their homes. They become much more housing insecure because more and more of them are paying more than 50% of their income just to put a roof over their heads and their children's heads. And so we've got still, even though we have fair credit law, we still have some gaps between what the law's intent is and the lives that women are leading. And we still have a way to go in sexual harassment. We did in 1991 have the Civil Rights Act of 1991, and for the first time again, women were fully able to recover their a loss when they proved that they had been discriminated against, including sexually harassed. Nevertheless, what I think has happened is that still, even though women can stake claims and they can sue, the most vulnerable who have to have those jobs, who need to have that income because otherwise they cannot put the roof over their heads, are not taking advantage of that. And I think that the problem of sexual harassment in colleges and universities is just now beginning to become part of where we need to be. So all of those things, we've made many great strides forward. We've still got a long way to go.
Thank you. Sandra Fluke, if we're worried about the pipeline for women in legal circles, I just have to look at Sandra Fluke and think there's nothing to worry about.
I could use a little help, right, though. I think we should still recruit.
Right. She stepped forward in February of 2012 when congressional Republicans prevented her from testifying, instead hearing only from a panel of men on women's health and the Affordable Care Act's definition of contraception as part of preventive care for women. She was vilified by Rush Limbaugh and many others and became a heroine for women speaking at the Democratic National Convention. And I'd like to ask you the same question I asked Anita, although it's been less than 2 years for you since this experience, which was both very personal and very public, how it affected you and how it changed your life and your mission.
Well, I think it gave all of us around the country a window into what was happening in many of our state legislatures as well as in Congress. Unfortunately, I think all too often we're not paying as close attention as we might have been. And that was really a moment, and it translated into a longer moment that was sustained throughout, I think, the 2012 campaign, where a lot of the country, especially women, also the men who care about us, were really paying attention to what was happening on reproductive health, reproductive justice, and rights. And what's really important now is that we not let that be just a moment that passed and think that the 2012 election fixed all of that. It didn't, in case anyone was wondering. That's really one of the places that we are today in terms of the status of women today is very much in a fight for not only legal and actual control of our bodies and our destinies in that respect, but also in a fight for the economic ability to actualize that control, to be able to access that health care. So I think that's one of the moments that we're in right now, and it's really important that not be the end of that story, because there were so many women who came to me and said, I can't believe we're talking about birth control again. I thought we accomplished this. I thought we fixed this. Raise your hand if you're in the room and you thought you fixed this. Thank you for all you did. Unfortunately, we're not done yet. So this was a really interesting sort of generational moment, right? Where I think maybe for some women of an earlier generation, there was a reminder that these fights were not over, that the fight did still need to go on. And perhaps for some young women, it was an introduction to this fight. Many folks have come to me and said, I'm so glad that young women showed up for the fight finally. And I want to say, we were already here. We were already here. But 2012 and the events that were happening and were so public seems to have been a moment where young women and women of prior movements and generations connected with each other a little bit more than they had before. If you talk with Cecile Richards, she'll tell you that the membership and supporters of Planned Parenthood increased exponentially, and many of those were young women and young men who were connecting to the mainstream organizations and, you know, as Eleanor Roosevelt said, realizing that that alienating oneself from the process won't accomplish the goals. But it was also a moment where I think some older generations realized that, yes, we not only have to teach leadership to our young people, as she said, we have to give them opportunities to lead as well. So I hope that going forward it'll be a reminder for the whole country of the importance of the reproductive justice fight, but a reminder of how important it is that we have both generations, many generations, working together in this effort, because that's how we can make the most progress. But listening to, you know, what we've heard today about the commission's report 50 years ago, it's really striking. Yes, so much has changed, but so much has not. And you listen to the sort of list of concerns: equal pay, child care, family leave, the Equal Rights Amendment. These are all still issues that, as we evidently are known to the former Mrs. Kennedy, the late Mrs. Kennedy, the harpies, are still working on, right? We're still fighting all of those battles. It is encouraging to see that there are some ways in which we're changing our tactics, and we're going into a different area for some of these fights. In particular, I was thinking about the domestic workers organizing efforts and also the fast food strikes. I'm sure many of you have seen the fast food strikes this year in the press. When we first opened today, we made reference to that 50 years ago was the March on Washington, and we forget that that was the March on Washington for both dignity and for jobs. one of the requirements and one of the requests of the marchers was a minimum wage of $2 an hour, which today, if you adjust for inflation, is right around $15, and that's what the fast food workers are fighting for. And that is not the type of fight that we might traditionally think of as being about where women are today, but it is where women are today. Two-thirds of fast food workers are women, many of them single mothers and heads of families. And I think that is a very real example of what a lot of on-the-ground harpy organizing for women is looking like today. It's a little bit outside of the organized union structure a little bit more, and it's bringing together the economic concerns of women specifically. The other item is the domestic workers organizing campaigns. Our historian on Eleanor Roosevelt was sharing with me that there were rumors of Eleanor clubs where supposedly she would get together the domestic workers and organize them and they would become a union and then there would be no one to clean your house. And this was one of the reasons that Eleanor Roosevelt was despised on that particular point, beloved on many others. Well, now we really do have Eleanor clubs. We really are organizing the domestic workers. So maybe she was ahead of her time on that point. But we're seeing incredible progress there, and that's largely about not only a female workforce, but the ways in which women's work, quote unquote, work that has always been associated with women, is viewed. And we, of course, have to acknowledge how much Secretary Solis did on that issue. So I'm encouraged by some of the ways in which this generation and this time, we are moving forward on many of the issues that the commission raised.
So you would embrace the title, if you will, of harpy.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I would hope to be an effective harpy, right, not just okay. a harpy. But yes.
And you're associated with a group called the Young Invincibles, and I've heard that term applied to young healthy people that the Obama administration is afraid are not going to show up and purchase health care. So tell me a little more about this group and what you're doing.
Yeah. So Young Invincibles is one of the groups that I work with. I'm not necessarily speaking officially on their behalf today.
Okay.
But they're an organization that they took their name from the idea that there was this cohort of young people who supposedly didn't want health care reform to happen because we all thought we were invincible and didn't need health insurance. In fact, we are the most uninsured generation and one desperately in need of health care reform, one that is turning out to sign up for health care reform and to sign up for the exchanges in droves because it is so important to us. So that's one of the issues that Young Invincibles works on. We also tackle economic concerns related to the affordability of education and to employment as well. My work there is taking a look at what's next for affirmative action, specifically race-based affirmative action in higher education. Because unfortunately, in terms of the status of women of color and men of color on that particular question, we need to find some next steps and a path forward that isn't just the end of that program.
What made you an activist? Was there a ha-ha moment when you were in college at Georgetown, I believe? Or is it your mother? Your what?
You know, I think anyone who has a true soul of an activist doesn't know how to answer that question because they were just always this, right? You know, you might have changed what you were working on, but you were always fighting, whether it was with your parents about the rules or at school or whatever. So I don't have an excellent answer to that question other than that I was instilled with a very strong sense of right and wrong from my parents and also a very strong sense of duty. And so while my parents and I don't always agree, they're pretty, a little bit more conservative than I am, about what right and wrong is, we very much agree on that you're absolutely not allowed to be on the sidelines.
Okay.
So pick up your tools and fight whichever side you're on.
That's an excellent answer. It's probably along the lines of what our next speaker will give as well. Former Secretary of Labor Hilda Solis, she has a long and distinguished career in electoral politics. She was first elected to public office in 1985 as a member of the Rio Hondo Community College Board of Trustees. And from there, she went on to serve in the California State Assembly, and then in 1994 became the first Latina elected to the California State Senate. She led the battle in the Senate to increase the state minimum wage from $4.25 to $5.75 an hour. That was 1996. I don't know what it is now, but it's still not a living wage, I'm sure. And she authored or co-authored 17 state laws combating domestic violence. She then served several terms in the Congress, the U.S. Congress, before joining the Obama administration in 2009. Labor laws, the environment, women's rights are all part of her portfolio. And you know, as a former member of Congress, I guess I'd like to start with your view of what you think as you look back on your former place of employment.
It was a lot better
right.
Before, but I do want to thank the folks that are sponsoring this event. I want to just really recognize the outstanding panelists that have already spoken and those that are going to be continuing to speak this evening. I want to also thank the Kennedy Library Foundation. In fact, one of the great events of my life was to receive, to be the first woman to receive the John F. Kennedy Profile in Courage Award because of my work on environmental justice and raising the minimum wage. And that was back when Senator Ted Kennedy was alive, and I'll never forget that moment. So this is about the third time I've been to Boston, and I'm just dying that those folks in the Congress could have the audacity not to get work done so that I couldn't go to the library today. Because all our employees there, government employees, are furloughed. But I want to say that so much has happened in the last 50 years since the first report came out, and yet so much more has to be done. And I'm reminded of an interesting person that is not mentioned in today's discussion, which to me is somebody that I look up to, and that's Frances Perkins, who was the first departmental secretary for the Department of Labor. And she actually lived out, I think, a lot of what Eleanor Roosevelt was aspiring to do and did do. And she was able to have that discussion, I think, with the president at that time and be in a room with other cabinet members and be the sole woman there defending the rights of children, poverty wages, to try to eradicate that, to provide better health care, and to also create social justice in a way that would kind of blanket all communities. And I'm reminded about the garment workers, where I think Frances Perkins stood across the street in New York to see this building with a bunch of immigrant young women that were flinging and just flying out of a building because it was on fire. These were garment workers, and there was no way of escaping because they didn't have good safety protection or any kind of type of plan set in place to protect women. These were low-wage immigrant workers, didn't have good command of the English language. I mean, these were folks that were just trying to make a living. And those kinds of things moved Frances Perkins, and because of that, we saw many reforms in the workplace. And now, as we see, I think, our labor laws changing, and we hear about some of the great things that are happening in terms of helping in-home healthcare workers, even cab drivers, and there are women cab drivers out there, believe it or not. But we also see where women, I think, have also been stuck. And I want to just give you a statistic, and this, some of you already know it. Women make 77 cents on the dollar compared to a man that's doing the same job. A woman of color who's African American will make about maybe 64 cents. A Latina, a woman who looks like me, will make about 54 cents. So talk about the wage gap. It's there, but we're not talking about it in ways that perhaps is so noticeable to us. And we still have to, I think, put all our efforts toward making sure that we have good enforcement mechanisms. That's why the Department of Labor has been able, in the past 5 years, at least through the Obama administration, to hire up new wage and hour division investigators so that things just don't go in a pile and sit there, but people actually get a call back from the department and are talked to, and issues like these are resolved and investigated. And we have an Office of Federal Contract Compliance that is required by law to make sure that any federal contracts that go out, that they treat individuals fairly, and that means women, people of color, people with disabilities, and veterans. We lost sight of, I think, a lot of that. I think what has happened is that we got comfortable, that we thought, wow, well, we don't maybe even need an office for the Women's Bureau. It was actually talk like that in the Congress. And thank goodness that people's voices were heard, because they would have eliminated it. And that's really discouraging, because there's so much more work to do. Maybe we have become more used to the notion that women can be acceptable in any position or any place. But when you look at the statistics and when you look at research, it doesn't bear that out. That's why it's still so important for us to have offices that do that kind of research. That's why it's important that we know who's in charge of medical advances, who's giving out the grants for research, who's giving out for jobs and contracts and things of that nature, and who gets selected to go and move up the ladder at the federal government level. We still have a disproportionate number of women that are not being allowed to get into the what we call the elite corps, the senior executive management positions in federal government, and very few men and women of color, women of color. And I say to myself, well, we have these laws in place, but are they being equally applied across the board? And I think in many cases we lose sight of that we've pulled back. We pulled back because in an era where we feel so hypersensitive about people talking about race, about this and that, no one wants to really talk about the white elephant in the room. And I think that it's time that we start bringing those barriers down. This president, in my opinion, really helped to set a standard by bringing more women, more people of color into his administration. And I'm thankful that I had the opportunity to serve for 4 years as the first Latina woman. We've had Hispanic men, but you never had a woman. Hopefully the next president will be able, she or he may have the opportunity to put more people who look like this room and who really truly represent the American public. And it's something that you have to continually strive for. Nothing is ever given to you. You have to work for it. And don't believe for a minute that we have yet arrived, because we still have so far to go. And we have so many other people behind us that are looking up to us to continue that fight. Whether they're young or old, I find them in every corner of this world where they're saying, please, just don't give up the fight. We need to have women to have equity. We need childcare. We need family medical leave implemented across the board in the public and private sector. We still have to change the behavior of some corporations that continue to discriminate against women and don't pay them their comparable worth. So we have a long way to go. But on the other hand, I am happy that we can have these open discussions, and that we need to have more men and more individuals who control the leverage, the levers of power, to really understand that we can sit there with them and make decisions and do the right thing for everybody.
Well, you were speaking earlier, and you said when you joined the Obama administration there was such a great optimism in early 2009, and that you kind of watched that erode, and now we look at the workers that are furloughed, and they're to most of the country they're sort of anonymous bureaucrats, but they're real people, and a lot of them are women, a lot of them are people of color, and government service is one of the great entrees into the middle class for a lot of people. If you could address that.
Well, I think that for many of us who grew up, we understood that government could actually allow for a more balanced level playing field in so many ways in our life, whether it was in education or job creation, things of that nature. And now it seems the public is very anti-government, and it isn't just the federal government, it's also the local government, because if you look at the losses that we've experienced over the last 5 years, it's been tremendous at the local level. About 600,000 jobs got wiped out. Most of those were women, teachers, firefighters, people who do your local services in your government. And to see that erosion is really a slap in our face, I think, for people who are trying to come up, and especially for those diverse communities. So we have to think about, as our economy recovers, where are we making sure that we're backfilling these positions, and who is getting in line for those positions, and to encourage people not to be down on federal government or state government, because it isn't government. Maybe that's too generic. We have to come up with something more simplistic, because it's the person who takes care of my mother or your father when ambulatory care has to come into place. Someone has to come pick up my dad, take him to the hospital, care for them. What about the person who's taking care of my pet, the veterinarian? Who's taking care of the street corner, the lights that went out? who's also taking care and minding when there's a major accident, like BP or a mining incident where people lose their lives. Who's going to be out and inspecting our poultry right now where we have a crisis in California? Those are all government workers. They may not all be federal, but they are government. And we have to think about what that means to our society. All of us agree to pay some form of tax. And somehow some people are saying that it's almost a sin to have to pay taxes. And I'm saying, well, wait a minute. Proportionally speaking, people who are in the middle class and lower pay a higher rate or percentage of taxes than the 2%. In fact, over the last, I think, 7 years, there's reports that indicate that the wealth of those 2% has increased by almost 200 and something percent. For the middle class, it's been down to about 20 and 19%. Those do not equate. They do not compare. And people need to wake up and understand that there is disparities that exist here and we have to correct them. And people need to have their voices heard. So I hope people are encouraged by getting involved and doing something and getting the Harpers and everybody else out.
Well, it's called starving the beast if you reduce the revenue coming in. I mean, that's the lingo. Professor Hill, your bio says your goal is to encourage creative, equitable, and positive resolution of race, gender, and class issues. It's a pretty big goal. How?
Laudable.
Right.
How's it going?
How's it going?
Well, you know, I think, I like to say that, you know, when I was coming up of age in the 70s, I actually thought that all of this was going to be sort of, you know, historic talk about how things were used to be. But, you know, that's not the case. We haven't changed and gotten to the place where we want to be. But it doesn't mean that we stop doing it. It doesn't mean that we stop trying to make things better for people. I think what the thing that I try to do, and you talked about activism, I think everybody comes at it in their own way. And I think that's what we have to understand, that I'm not going to be the same kind of activist as you, and I'm not going to run for public office, but that everyone in here who really believes in equality and who has a function in life and a brain to think and a mouth to speak with has an opportunity to promote it. And I just met this young woman who's organizing in her high school now. So every one of us has a role that we can play. It's not easy, especially not easy, I think, in this era, this sort of post-identity era, where most of us didn't realize that we're now post-race, all the isms are gone. But what I think has to happen is that we've got to be very thoughtful, and we've got to think, you know, one, where are the gaps in the law? How do we fill them? What are some of the new strategies that we can engage in? Who are the decision makers? And whether they're men or women, what do they need to know to make the best decisions for us? We've got to think in the long term whether it is important for us to start thinking, maybe necessarily or unnecessarily, are women one monolithic group? I don't think we are. Of course not. But what benefit can we gain when we start to look down and sort of drill down and start looking at people's, women's life experiences across their entire life cycle, so that we're not just talking about one thing that needs to happen for women like childcare, but we're talking about what needs to happen for women from the time they're born into the world to improve their chances of successful outcomes by the time that they get older, and as what we're reading now, becoming more and more impoverished. So we've got to be very smart and very thoughtful. We've got also to start looking at the impact of race on a woman's experience. What is it like when you quote the statistics of women of color and the wage gap? What is it like to be a woman of color working with earning 54 cents to a dollar? Even in the terms of the judiciary, the numbers that I look at We, about a third of the federal judiciary are women. But 68 out of the 750 federal judges in the country are women of color. So what is that, you know, we've got to really kind of look at these holistically. We have to look at women's lives as thing as something that are very complex. So there are no simple solutions. Mm-hmm. But it does begin with a dialogue. And I'll just say this, and I talked about the men and the women arguing. Things can change. Let me tell you, when I first testified in 1991, I was getting lots of letters, and I still get lots of letters. And in 1991, I would say between 80 and 90% of the letters that I got were from women. And over the time, over the years, 20 years, 30, you know, now going on 30, that ratio has changed. And so I'm getting a lot more supportive letters from men who come to the experience, whether it's sexual harassment or just the ability to speak out for what they believe in. But they come in a positive way, in an evolved way. Now, some men come through their experiences of their daughters, but what is there, I think, whether it's because of their daughters or something that they've experienced in their lives, is some kind of empathy, some ability to relate to what it's like to try to make positive change and to be confronted by people who just don't want things to change. And I think that's how we're going to be able to move. When women earn more money and can support their family, everybody benefits. When women can live in safe and secure homes, everybody benefits. The society benefits. And we've got to begin to kind of understand, to break down some of those differences, but not lose focus of the fact that there's still a gender disadvantage in this country. And it's interesting, 50 years ago in that report, that's one of the premises they started out with, mm-hmm. that there is a disadvantage to being a woman in this country. It still exists, but what we have to make sure that people understand is that disadvantage is not women's alone. The entire society suffers because of it.
Well, we've talked a lot today about labor movements, women's movements, civil rights movements, and I want to ask Sandra about organizing in the 2010s, but first I want to go to the question here. Okay.
So, as you pointed out before, I made the Women's Rights Awareness Group in my high school. But when the idea first came to my head, I asked one of my male teachers what he thought about it. And I said, oh, I'm thinking about making a feminism group at the high school. And he goes to me, he's like, well, if you make a feminism club, the boys will have to gather and make a masculinist club. Oh. And I said, with all due respect, sir, the United States of America is a masculinist club. So my question is kind of a two-part question, because also as I look around in this room, I don't really see enough girls my age here learning about this moment in history. And I worry about what I have to do as my leader in my club, how to first be taken seriously, because when I said that to my teacher, I didn't really feel like he was taking my club or my actions or my activism seriously. And how do I attract girls my age to this cause? Because I feel like they know what it is, obviously from their mothers, but I feel like they don't know exactly what it means, so I'm just worried of how I'm supposed to attract people my age to this.
I have so many things to say on this. So an excellent question, but don't ask us. Because we're old, sorry, guys. Tell us. tell us what would bring young people into this kind of conversation? And I know that's a hard question, and it takes a lot of work to come up with the answer, and I'm constantly trying to think of ways, to your point of organizing, of reaching, you know, whether it's young people or various audiences that we don't reach, that we don't activate adequately. But the key to that is asking those groups. So each of us, especially those of us who are young women in this conversation, has to take on the responsibility of figuring that out, talking to the rest of our generation, figuring that out, and then telling the rest of the movement and the leaders, and hoping that other aspects of the leadership and of the movement will be willing to hear us on what it will take. You know, I wanted to also offer to you one other response to your teacher. Which yours was very good. But one other response might be, okay, so let's broaden the conversation a little bit about what a feminism club would focus on and what its goal would be. Because I think, you know, 50 years ago, it was called the Commission on the Status of Women. And today we have a lot of those types of commissions that have very similar titles, and, you know, the office within the White House that focuses on women and girls. And I wonder if we didn't have that history of names, what we would call it if we were starting afresh today? I think we might call it something more like the Commission on Gender or Sex Equality, or Inequality, rather. Mm-hmm. And that is absolutely not, you know, as Professor Hill pointed out, to erase the very unique and disproportionate impact that discrimination has on women specifically, but to broaden the conversation to be about what are all the ways that all of us are harmed by sexism, by gender roles that limit who we can be. How does that harm men as well? Not just the ways in which society has denied women's talents and abilities when women are limited, but what are the things that many of our sons wish they could be, but don't feel that they're able to be within our society? If you think about, you know, one really concrete example is that the way men are taught to deal with their emotions, or rather to not deal with their emotions. There's some research that shows it actually shortens their lifespan in the United States because of the limitations we put on boys expressing their feelings. So there are ways in which all of us are harmed by these types of gender roles. And, you know, something that's very, very much in the minds of our generation's organizing. Is it okay if I claim to be in the same generation?
Of course.
We're like close enough, right?
Yeah.
Something that's very much in the minds of young people organizing today are a movement within the transgender community. And that type of thinking about how gender limits all of us is absolutely what that fight is about. So that type of a frame, I think, is an interesting thing to think about for where we go forward from here, because it does bring other people into the conversation and into the fight. Because why aren't the boys part of the feminism club or the gender equality club, right? I hope that they are. I know there were there were quite a few guys in my such group when I was a student. But that absolutely doesn't mean that we in any way lose focus on what is still the disproportionate impact on women in this country, especially when we consider things like violence against women and those types of concerns.
Thank you.
So does she go and try to recruit friends in her school individually? How does one go about sparking a movement? It seems to me what happened in your case was that the issue of contraception related to the Affordable Care Act actually made young women think that they had a stake in this. I mean, it's believing you have a stake in some political fight that gets people interested. And people have a stake in all these fights, but they don't make the connection. So I guess the issue is, how do you get them to see that they can actually have an impact on Washington?
Well, it seems that we're coming at it from the wrong direction, right? Rather than trying to convince people that they have a stake, shouldn't the question be that we ask them, well, what is it you're worried about? What is it you that's not working in your lives that you want to change, that you want to fight for? Okay, let's organize around that. Because that's when they feel they have a stake. And perhaps that opens the door to some further conversations of, well, you know, here's a policy that you had no idea was impacting your life, but let's talk about how that relates to this concern that you have. But it, you know, it can't be a top-down, you all should know that you should be concerned about X, Y, Z. That's not gonna galvanize people, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I definitely think that there are a lot of ways that you can galvanize people. I think everyone is different. What reaches some people won't reach other people. But I do agree with you that you have to get to people what they care about. What really do you care about? Some people will be concerned about things that are sort of ideas. Other people will be concerned about things that are just their day-to-day living. You know, this is. But what I do think is that we organize, and maybe this is because so much is coming out of Washington, that we organize. I don't think we have to organize around the political.
Right.
I think we need to organize around what's going on in our lives. I mean, if you want to think about in terms of what you're going to change in Washington, that's one thing. But you might also just want to change what's in your workplace, what people are being required to do, whether or not people are going to have vacation or sick leave, or whether or not how people are being paid in your workplace, or you know whether people are given leeway to go and take off and take care of a sick child or a sick parent. I mean, all organizing doesn't have to be directed at Washington, D.C. We can change the way we live and the way women experience
life. Maybe that's the big difference between 50 years ago and today, because 50 years ago, government and Washington and politics was seen as the most direct avenue for change. And it's an overworked term, but
we have to fight on multiple levels. Yeah. I, of course, as a lawyer, I think we've got to, you know, women should be encouraged to sue for their rights. You know, was that so radical when you saw that as a headline? Yes, mm-hmm. We should be suing for our rights. But that should not be the only avenue. Because what we have to realize is that when you're talking about people who are particularly vulnerable, either economically or socially, they're not going to go to the courts. Because one, they can't afford to, or they can't even project what the outcomes will be.
Sure.
So there ought to be other avenues for us to move people forward mm-hmm. that don't require us to file a lawsuit. I'm all for them, trust me. but they should not be required for us to move forward.
Right.
Can I say something, though? Something that I think is really important as well is, while we see the dysfunction in Washington playing itself out in the last, I think, 4 years, quite frankly, people have to be reminded that a lot of things happen locally and that people shouldn't lose sight, especially women. We're losing so many good women that are now dissuaded from running for public office. In Los Angeles County, we just had an election on the city council. We, out of like 12 members, just one woman. She barely squeezed through. This is horrendous that we're going backwards and not forwards. The California State Legislature, because that's the one I know the best, we have lost ground in terms of having more women state senators as well as assembly members. Why are women afraid to do that? Because ask those questions. Why? Do they not have money? Do they not have support at home? Is there a structure in life such that it doesn't allow them to have time to go out there and do that? I mean, these are questions we have to ask ourselves as a society and then figure this out if we want to really see equality. And while I don't think everyone is made up to get into politics, I do think it's an important voice. Because when you do have women, in many cases, when you're in those discussions where you have to make those decisions, women, and people say this all the time, women look at things very differently. It's about the group. It isn't about my having power over someone else or leaving that discussion and saying, gee, I won that one. It's not about that in many ways. I think a lot of women in leadership in public office look at the benefit of how they can help so many more people. And that's why you see people like former Speaker Nancy Pelosi, who I think has been a tremendous, tremendous asset for women in the legislature, helping to groom and mentor other women. And her effect is so profound, I think it's really underestimated right now. Women of this day and age don't fully understand the contributions that this one woman has made, and keeping at bay also people alongside her who would love to have her position. So I mean, just think about that, maneuvering the House, getting bills through, and working with the president at that time to get Lilly Ledbetter and other good legislation. And thank goodness we had some good women in the Senate and in the House, because we were able to get some of the funding that we needed at a time when the other side was saying, oh no, the government is too big. And it's outrageous when the unemployment rate at that time was 10%. And maybe 16 and 20% for people of color in communities around the country.
Right. Well, I think we want to leave this panel with a note of optimism. And so if I could ask each of you, maybe Sandra, you want to start
sure.
as to what you see on the horizon that can give us some reason to be happy about the progress we've made and are about to make.
Well, you know, I'll start by just addressing the point that Secretary Solis was raising of, you know, why aren't we seeing more women stepping forward into office and into to leadership? You know, sometimes I worry that it's because we spend a lot of time talking about the barriers. And it's good to acknowledge the barriers and talk about the challenges. Absolutely, that's how we work on them. But we have to not get stuck there. And as individual women, on believing that we can't do it because of all of those barriers that we're aware of. You know, I don't want to run for office because I'll be personally attacked and vilified in the press. Well, we're all still here. So, you know, if the three of us can handle it. Rock stars perhaps, but super women know if we can handle it, so can so many women. And we need a lot more belief in ourselves in that way, because I suppose that's my optimism in the end, is that we absolutely have the capacity to change all of what we've been talking about today, and we will eventually. Yeah. We will.
Right. I always think of FDR took criticism. He said, it's a badge of honor. I wear this as a badge of honor.
Yeah.
You've had your share of criticism.
Of honor.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have. Yeah. And it's amazing. I always tell people, if I can be optimistic, anybody should be. But what does make me optimistic, there are two things. One is that, again, so much has changed. I've seen it in my lifetime. And if I think about, you know, the fact that I grew up in rural Oklahoma, not Australia, but in rural Oklahoma, the life chances that people would have given to me for an African-American girl growing up in rural Oklahoma, ever, one, getting to law school or graduating from college, Yale Law School, to be able to move and work into where I am today. And as I tell people, I move all the way from Oral Roberts University to Brandeis, so I've come a long way across the spectrum. But the chances of that happening for me were not great. They were, in fact, very small. So I know what we can do. I know what is possible. And I also know that I didn't do it alone. I did it because there were a lot of people behind me, and there were a lot of government programs, and there was a movement behind me. I've seen it happen in my lifetime, and I can see it possibly happening in the future. Because when I get to fly around and talk to groups, I see so many people of goodwill who do care and are willing to work to make things better. The other things that makes me optimistic is the alternative. I can't be pessimist. I can't give up. If that's the only alternative, then I prefer to be optimistic and just to keep working.
Yeah. I think that's a nice note to end on. So thank you very much. And thank you all for coming, and go forth and multiply.
Thank you.
Right.